Good evening, everyone. Thank you for joining us today. My name is Akshay. I'm extremely delighted to welcome you all to the 7th Conversations on RTI session. We have a special session planned for you today where Shailesh Gandhi sir will be speaking with former Chief Information Commissioner Satyananda Mishra. Let me just say, we are extremely delighted to have you both here today. I thank you both for taking the time to be here. For those of you who are new, Manilai Foundation is a non-profit organization primarily engaged in spreading financial literacy and advocacy for savers. Our RTI center, supported by the Thakur Foundation, has been doing its best to promote the use of RTI in various ways, including the RTI Advice app, which allows users to ask questions regarding their RTI application to a panel of experts in the language of their choice, in either text, audio, or video. My colleagues will share a link of the app in the chat if you wish to download it. Before we begin, allow me to also take the time to share a few ground rules about the session. We have kept all of you on mute, so we'll unmute you only during the Q&A session. For optimal viewing, I would suggest that you keep the webinar on speaker view. This meeting is being recorded and a recording will be uploaded to our YouTube channel, OneLife TV. During the Q&A session, I would request that you use the raise hands button available on Zoom if you wish to ask any questions. Also, a sincere request to please keep your questions short, below 90 seconds. Please feel free to use the chat section to post your comments, questions, or observations, but do send it in a public forum to everyone. We will not be able to monitor any questions that you send to us privately while the session is live. Please also note that by default, your cameras may be on and you may be broadcasting your background or your homes to everyone. If you would like to keep your cameras off to maintain your privacy, you may do so now. Now, without taking too much of your time, I would ask Gandhi sir to please take over. Sir, over to you.
Good evening to all of you. Thank you very much for joining today. And my special thanks to Satyananji, who was my boss when I was in the commission. And he was a boss who it was a pleasure to serve. Thank you, Satyananji, and welcome to this conversation.
Thank you, Shailesh ji. I was no boss. I was your colleague. I was your student.
No, you're being very kind, sir. Satyananji, to start the conversation today, would you briefly describe your journey as a public servant? I know you were chairman and managing director of MCX, but you've done a lot of roles. You've been secretary, DOPT, and many other departments. Would you briefly like to tell us about your journey as a public servant?
Yeah. You know, I completed 42 years in the public sector, 1.5 years in the beginning as a probationary officer in State Bank of India, then 36 years in the Indian Administrative Service, half of which was spent in Madhya Pradesh, which was the state to which I was allotted, then half of it in Government of India, and then 5 years in the CIC, out of which 2 years was as Information Commissioner and 3 years as Chief Information Commissioner. Out of these 5 years, 4 years were spent in your company. So these 42 years in the public service, you know, like any other officer, I worked in a wide variety of departments: town planning, urban administration, small scale industries, public health engineering, public works department, culture, and so on. I mean, apart from being district collector of districts and such other jobs. After I finished my, you know, reached the age of 65, when you have to finally call it a day in the government, I have been working on various, you know, boards as independent director. I was an independent director on the board of SIDB. I was with Multi Commodity Exchange. I am with one mutual fund these days, with an NBFC. Just recently, I have been appointed as a public interest director in the CDSL IFSC in GIFT City. You know this. So these are, but mostly last 5 years I have spent in supervising the construction of a one of the largest hospitals of India, which is coming up in Faridabad. It's a 2,000-bed hospital, multi-speciality hospital, along with a medical college, which is being set up by the Kerala-based charitable trust called Mata Amritanandamayi Math Trust, which is headed by the guru whom we popularly know as Amma. So this keeps me occupied in the last 5 years. That is the reason why I am in Delhi. Even after retirement, I spend time there looking after the hospital. So this is by and large what my public life has been since 1971, when I completed my master's in English literature, till now. So,
incidentally, being your colleague, I had the opportunity of being introduced to a beautiful Odia dish, chana powder. Thank you very much, sir.
Exactly. Yeah.
Satyananji, it's been over 16 years now since RTI was introduced.
Yes.
As a national law. How would you rate its journey?
You know, you would remember that I joined the Ministry of Personnel as an additional secretary in 2006, just about 10 months after the RTI Act was notified in 2005. So I was absolutely right there, as it were, when the RTI Act was unfolding. And I recall Mr. Arvind Kejriwal, accompanied by his deputy, Mr. Sisodia, Manish Sisodia, had visited my office in connection with an RTI application, which they had filed to know about how officers are empaneled at the level of additional secretary and secretary in Government of India, and we said no to their request, and ultimately that matter went to the CIC, which I discovered when I joined the CIC. So what had happened that in the beginning, when the UPA government agreed to pass the law, and this is a very unique law, the draft of which was not made by the Government of India, the draft of the law was made by the activists. They handed over the draft to the UPA chairperson, who in turn handed it over to the Department of Personnel, and they tweaked marginally here and there, and the law was passed. So that is the reason why you would see that the language of RTI Act is not the same as the language of other laws. I mean, it is completely in a layman's language. There is no legalese, there is no complicated legal jargon. So this is one feature which distinguishes the RTI Act. Second, the RTI Act has been, since it was drafted by the activists, it is a maximalist act. I mean, for a country which was starting its journey, giving its citizens for the first time the right to information held by the government, and here the government was replaced by the word public authority, thereby extending the limits of the government to far more entities than mere government would have been. So for a law, for giving this right for the first time, the government gave so much, and it was simply unbelievable. I'm sure that you, as an RTI activist, since you were personally involved in the drafting of this law, you were part of the movement which led to the passing of this law, you yourself would have been also surprised how the government agreed to so much. I remember that 2 years after when I joined the CIC, once in a some official dinner, I met Mr. Chidambaram. He was then the finance minister. He told me, he said that, Mr. Misra, I think that the government should have introduced this law in as a pilot with some bits of rights. I mean, government gave far too much rights. It's not possible to really deal with this. I mean, that is the kind of feeling which was inside the government. And I would not claim that I had any different view. I mean, when I was in the government, when an RTI application would come, one would feel, sense of irritation that how come these people are asking for these questions? It is slowly that when I, after retirement, I joined the CIC, and realized that this was a law which was needed more by retired people than serving people. If they are in the government, of course, every citizen of India needs it. So the journey of the RTI Act has seen the high, then seen the peak. And some say, you are in the field, I'm not in the RTI field anymore. But some say that the peak of RTI is now over. I mean, you will pass the judgment, right? But I was really surprised the other day. I met one government officer who is about to retire as a secretary and probably would apply for the job of information commissioner in CIC. He was telling me, ki, sir, ye law kuch dhila pad gaya. So this is the kind of feeling, you know, people within the government think. So 16 years, yes, it is a long time. No other law had this kind of success. The kind of success RTI Act has. That RTI is a name which has almost become a verb. It is no longer a noun. They say that I'll RTI. I mean, it is like, so therefore RTI has become a vocabulary of common usage. So that is its sign of success. But I don't know. I mean, you would know better.
My perspective on the downward trend is that it has been adjudicated very badly. One of the best laws in the world is being adjudicated in a manner distorting the law completely that the parliament has passed. And the law that we drafted originally, it is no longer that law. Words have been given meanings which the law cannot ever intend. But this has been done by various adjudicators. It's not just the commissions. Having said that, what is your... The RTI commissioners, there is a preponderance of bureaucrats. Very rare RTI activists have become commissioners. What is your view? How would RTI activists be as commissioners?
Yeah, as you know, you were the first RTI activist to join the Central Information Commission.
Was I the last also?
Yeah, probably you are the last. I don't know what you call Mr. Mahurkar, who is now one of the information commissioners. Probably he's a journalist. He is not an RTI activist that way. Samlal Yadav, BP had become an RTI information commissioner. You could call him a journalist, also an activist. But you were the first RTI activist to join. And when the then government chose you, I don't know what was the background, how did they choose you, though I was myself the secretary. I processed the file and we passed the order in the same order. Your name, my name appeared. But I don't know exactly how that name came to the government of India. I mean, the name was given to us from the Prime Minister's office. But my personal experience with you as the Information Commissioner was excellent because you possessed a very tremendous sense of balance. While your commitment to the cause of RTI was paramount, but you were not a fanatic, a kind of a fundamentalist, RTI fundamentalist. That means everything can go to hell, right to information is... you understood there are compulsions within the government. The government, the way the government is structured, the information keeping in the government is in such shape that it is not possible always to find very categorical, unequivocal, unambiguous kind of response from the government. And you also knew that the citizens were also new to this. They also didn't know what exact information they should be seeking. So you struck a very fine balance. As far as the former bureaucrats are concerned, I agree with you that, there are probably 95-98% of information commissioners across the country should be drawn from the civil service. That is also true of all other, whether it is the Union Public Service Commission or the CAG or Election Commission, or name the adjudicatory or tribunals or commissions, everywhere the civil servants, as a former civil servant, I might be a bit prejudiced, but I would think that civil servants by themselves are not bad to be bad information commissioners. It is only when a civil servant continues to think that he is still in the government and in the awe of the government and thinks that he has to pay back because the government has made him the information commissioner, the problem arises. You have seen that Wajahat Habibullah, who was the first chief information commissioner and was pretty close to the chairperson of the UPA. I mean, he was a classmate of Mr. Rajiv Gandhi and he was very close to them. He served in the Congress government at the Prime Minister's level. But he was bold enough file noting, for example, the file noting order. I mean, he could pass that order. So therefore, we have good examples, but by and large, the examples have not been very good. I agree with you that more RTI activists, balanced types who like you would weigh the pros and cons of things and pass an order. I think we need more of them to lend legitimacy to the commissions. Many commissions have just lost their legitimacy.
Incidentally, sir, my selection was a random occurrence. It's a very funny story. Yeah. There was no process. Nobody knew me in Delhi. But that apart, don't you think there should be some criteria, minimum criteria and desirable criteria for selection of information commissioners?
Yeah, absolutely. There is no doubt about it because the law is very, vague and general. It simply, of course, a law cannot be more specific than what it is. It only gives the broad fields from which the information commissioners can be drawn. Public administration, management, law, science, technology, etc. So it is for the executive government of the day to really decide from which stream they should draw the information commissioners. Unfortunately, what happens that the governments across times and across space in India have worked on mostly patronage. So if some officer has been good in the sense that has not been a deviant type, so if he is retiring, then fix him somewhere. Either RTI, this information commission is a very extremely potential place because it has 10 vacancies. There are 10 posts of information commissioner and one chief information commissioner. That means the 11 people can be fixed. And you recall that in the earlier days, governments like a government of Punjab or government of even Arunachal Pradesh, which had a population of just 5 lakh people, had almost all the 10 vacancies filled up. I mean, so patronage is which works in the government by and large everywhere. I mean, not only in the information commission. Second point I have a feeling, Celestia, is this, that governments throughout, including the UPA government, which brought the RTI Act, were not really very, very keen on this RTI Act. They had never, for example, the UPA government, having enacted that law, soon realized that it was a Frankenstein for them. So they were, you recall that they would not provide the budget, they would not sanction posts. We had to do with in the Central Information Commission with the retired people taken on almost daily wages to help us as in the office as assistants or our registrars and so on. We did not have a building. I mean, finally, when the UPA government allotted us a place to have the Central Information Commission, it was in the periphery of Delhi, whereas National Investigation Agency, NIA, which came several about it, probably a decade after or five, seven, 8 years after us, has got its office in the central government office complex in Lodi Road. So the RTI as a law and information commission as an adjudicating body within that law receive the list importance from the government of the day. And so combined the and then the courts, which could have probably the judiciary, which could have really prevented this kind of downslide, it added to the downslide, because they themselves also thought very poorly of the information commissions. And would you ask me, if you ask me, why do they think that way? I'll tell you why they think it that way. Because unlike other commissions, for example, TRAI, there is an appellate tribunal over TRAI, TDSAT. Then there is an appellate tribunal called the National Consumer Grievance Redressal Commission. There is what is called NCLAT or NCLT. In all these places, the judges have managed to find vacancies for former judges. It is only in the Information Commission that they have not found a place to fix one of their retired judges. So they don't see any reason to support the Information Commissions. And then you caused problem by asking them inconvenient questions. When Subhas Agrawal asked for the copy of the notings of the collegium selection of judges, you passed an order that this should be disclosed. So they got annoyed.
That is very true, sir. That is very, very true. It's very unfortunate that this has happened. And the courts themselves have been reluctant. They passed lots of proclamations on transparency in government.
Yeah.
But they had never imagined, I mean, from my perspective, bureaucrats and politicians had been used to giving answers to questions being questioned by citizens. They may not have provided the information from the records, but they were used to this. The courts were not used to this at all. So for them, I think it was a traumatic shock that citizens would ask for questions from them. Sir, you were responsible for passing that order on political parties being under RTI. That order was not followed. What do you believe should have been done?
Yeah, you know, this is, many people often ask me this question, that it was passed in 2013 and we are now in 2021. 8 years have gone by and the order of the CIC has not been implemented. A, the political party which was in power, which had actually constituted the Central Information Commission, it did not agree to implement that. The party which succeeded them has also declined to implement that order. When people went to the Supreme Court, it remanded that thing back to the CIC for something. What for? It could have passed an order. It has passed many orders. It has passed orders that everybody contesting the election must file an affidavit declaring, disclosing their assets. So they could have also passed an order in this case. What did we ask for? We didn't ask for any secret information. We simply wanted, I mean, if this order had been implemented, citizens would have gone and asked that, Bhai Sahib, ye bataiye ke how much, what is the kind of contribution you have received, how are you spending it, and things of that kind. I mean, not more than that. So, but even then they refused to, and the courts didn't help. No government has agreed to do this. And I don't know what can be done.
And in the case of RBI,
yes,
you had passed one order, I had passed 10 orders, which were upheld by the Supreme Court of India in December 2015.
Yes.
But it's not being implemented. And in fact, it's on record that the Supreme Court, I think 2 years back or 3 years back, warned RBI, we'll take contempt action, but no action is being taken either.
Yeah, I know. You can't do, actually, it is, as you know, Shailesh ji, law or is a kind of a social contract between the executive and the citizens, and only when the executive and the citizens are on the same page, then only a law can be implemented effectively. on the matter of RTI, while the citizens might be on one page, the executive is not on the same page. Judiciary, of course, is not on the same page because judiciary thinks itself to be
above the law.
Not above the law, but they think that who are these people, imposters who have not been judges? How could they ask us questions? You recall the first thing they passed this order that the judicial side of the court's proceedings is beyond RTI. What is then within the RTI? The how many chairs the Supreme Court has or how many vehicles Supreme Court has? This is, I mean, is this what the people of India want to know from the Supreme Court or the High Court? And then how dare they, in Allahabad High Court, you recall, they had made a rule that for every question in the RTI, if you are asking 5 questions, then for each question, pay 500 rupees as your fee. When the government of India and Supreme Court are asking for 10 rupees for the whole RTI application. So there has been a complete unanimity among the powers that be to somehow weaken the right to information.
Does this indicate a lack of institution building in the country?
See, what has happened that we inherited or we established many institutions under the Constitution of India. Though Central Information Commission is not a constitutional body. If you recall, Shailesh Ji, when this was passed and some years later, Mr. Rahul Gandhi was reported in the press to have said that if he had his wish, then he would have made it into a part of the constitution. Truly speaking, like the Central Election Commission or Union Public Service Commission, the Central Information Commission should have become a constitutional body because it originates in the fundamental rights of the constitution. The Article 19 is the source, fountainhead from which the right to information emerges. So therefore, if any tribunal or commission was to be made a constitutional entity, this commission should have been that. But they didn't make that. So now the right to information is finally the baby of the RTI activists and some journalists or reporters.
Sir, to take it to another topic, Girish Deshpande judgment has, in my opinion, amended the law illegally and unconstitutionally. Your views on this, on Section 81J and the Girish Deshpande judgment?
You know, you remember when this judgment was passed by the bench headed by Justice Deepak Mishra, who later became the Chief Justice of India. We had at that time itself had a laugh about this order. Because this order says that the relationship between a public servant and the government is a personal relationship. I mean, how on earth I draw my salary from the government, I'm an officer or an employee of the government, how can my relationship with my employer be a personal one? I'm not somebody's domestic help or working in as a gomasta in some grocery shop. I'm a public servant. People of India are paying my salary out of the consolidated fund of India. How can my relationship with the government be a personal one? And if you are asking information about me, about inquiries against me, he says that it is a personal information. It is strange. I mean, you know, same Supreme Court, I must also commend them that when Justice Swatantra Kumar bench passed that very funny order saying that only judges or people with legal background can become information commissioners and created a kind of crisis for the information commission, the same Supreme Court a few months later repealed this order as a wrong order. They themselves repealed the order. So I believe that the Supreme Court should repeal that order, that Girish Deshpande order is so absolutely preposterous. and without any standing, that the Supreme Court itself should have the grace and the, you know, magnanimity to repeal that order.
Sir, from one perspective, do you believe the Information Commissioner can pass an order saying that the Girish Deshpande judgment is per incurium, which it is?
I would think that that would be expecting, you know, disproportionately from the Information Commission. So once Supreme Court has passed an order, and for an Information Commissioner to say that that order is not applicable and I don't not refer to that order or ignore the reference to that order and pass an order, one could try. I mean, I don't think any Information Commissioner has done that, but it could be tried and to see
what lays down the law or in a Supreme Court judgment is the thing and the legal principle.
Yeah,
there is no reasoning in the Girish Deshpande judgment, and there is no ratio decidendi. Therefore, strictly legally, I believe it is something that can be done, and the only savior can be if Information Commission start passing orders that as per law, this is what it means. Girish Deshpande applies only to one particular case.
Yeah, I agree with you that one could make an effort if one Information Commissioner in some Information Commission passes such an order and it again ends up in the Supreme Court, maybe that would be a trigger for Supreme Court to re-look at that order and review it.
Okay, we could have a long, really long conversation, but there is a time limitation. So we'll open up for questions, Satyanand ji, from the participants.
Okay. It has been a pleasure, Sailesh ji, to talk to you.
No, thank you very much, sir. Akshay?
May I start? May I have the privilege of the first question?
Sure. Suchita would like to ask the first question. Yeah. Please go ahead, Suchita.
So, Mr. Mishra, thank you so much for being exceedingly candid and very hard-hitting in your comments. I think it's been a very, very interesting session and to hear you speak. So one of the things that I wanted to ask you is that, you know, now you've been on so many companies that are related to markets in different ways. You're on their board. One of the things that you would have noticed is how little information is provided under RTI by the exchanges themselves. I mean, National Stock Exchange has managed to go and block everything, the CIC order, even a Delhi High Court single judge bench is gone to the division bench. It ensures that it never comes up. Don't you think that the government or the Securities and Exchange Board of India itself could easily pass an order asking at least the two exchanges and later the depositories and others to say, please comply with the act, because you are a public authority and you ought to be revealing more information? Would you like to say something on it?
Yeah. I can't agree more with you. Having been in the multi-commodity exchange myself, I used to tell the people right there in those days that because I had just gone out of the Central Information Commission, I was asking them that why should they not provide information to the people if they ask for money? As long as you are not revealing the business secrets of your stakeholders, there are many types of information which these exchanges should disclose freely. I mean, it would only add to their stature rather than, I don't know why should they be, you know, reluctant to give information. This is, and I fully agree with you that SEBI, as the market regulator, the regulator of these exchanges and the depositories and the mutual funds, I think that SEBI should take a proactive role in implementing RTI in some of these institutions.
We have one query posted by Mr. Rama Prasad. He's talking about the Telangana Chief Secretary's order. So, and what he's saying is that although there is a stay order given by the High Court, the PIOs and the appellate authorities are still not giving answers to people. They're not giving information to people. So how it can be resolved? I mean, what they can do now?
No, I do not know what is the order of the Chief Secretary of Telangana. Has he said that nobody should disclose any information, something like that?
No. The Chief Secretary has said that every PIO should refer to his superior before sharing any information. He should get an order from the superiors.
So this is a patently wrong direction, because PIO, the public information officer, whether central public information officer or state public information of a public authority, is a legal entity. He is an independently recognized legal entity within the ambit of the Right to Information Act. Nobody, not even the chief secretary, has a right to direct him how to behave. He must exercise his own discretion. If it is found that he has been acted under somebody else's direction, then he would be, liable for punishment. Shailesh ji would remember that in many high courts, before the information was disclosed, the information officers were to take the approval of the of a judge who had been designated. So we had taken objection to these things, but then of course, so the High Court, so what do you do? I mean, but in the case of an executive like a chief secretary, if he has passed this order, this is a wrong order, and I suppose the courts should strike down that order, or people should agitate against this kind of order. Their public representatives should bring this up before in the state assembly and question the chief minister and the government why such an order has been passed.
Yeah.
Incidentally, Satyananji, Sridhar Acharyalu and I have written to the chief secretary suggesting that if he feels the level of the PIO is incompetent, they should raise the level of the PIO.
No, that is one thing. I mean, whosoever is the PIO.
That's right.
Why should he be asking his superior whether the information should be disclosed? You see, it is very undiplomatic on the part of that man. If he wanted, I mean, it happens everywhere that if the PIO gets an inconvenient, supposing the public information officer of a public sector undertaking gets an RTI application that please tell me how many times your CMD had traveled in the last 1 year and how many night halts he made, how much was spent on his air travel and hotel bill, etc. While dealing with this, you would surely go and ask informally the CMD or CMD's personal secretary, Kisab, we have received this kind of a, should we give it? What can we give it? That is a different thing that you and I would not know. But for the CMD to pass an order that in future, if you get an RTI application about my office, then first come and clear it with me, will be going against the RTI Act. I mean, it is totally against the RTI Act's provisions. Illegal.
Yes, sir. So, sir, there is one more question that Supreme Court has ruled that RBI should share the inspection reports of banks. But despite the Supreme Court ruling, banks keep going to the Supreme Court again and again, and the hearing goes on. And in the meanwhile, the bank said, okay, it's in court. The case is in the court, so we can't disclose the information. So we have been denying all the information. I mean, they don't share the inspection reports, or why the bank is in loss. They don't share the information. So how this can be dealt?
Yeah, yes. Celeste was referring to that, this very thing. You know, just like the political parties have very merrily defied the CIC order on coming under the RTI Act, the Reserve Bank of India is also doing the same thing, and nobody is taking any. See, what happens that as when unless the Supreme Court in this case, in the case of whether political parties or in the case of RBI inspection reports comes out very categorically, like they have been coming out categorically in many cases. I mean, in many cases where probably it was not expected from them to step in, but they have still stepped in and passed very categorically orders for the government to implement. So in this case, they could themselves pass such orders, but unfortunately they have not. We can only pray and hope that they would do it someday.
Is it also a question of, the richest people getting access to the courts repeatedly? Because you would notice that it's not so much the RBI, it is the banks that are going to court. They can hire the most expensive lawyers and keep agitating the same thing. So when there is a court order, you know, 10 of Shailesh Gandhi's judgments, there was one order. There's a second order. Then Prashant Bhushan has, you know, argued some cases, there are orders. But everything, a Supreme Court case has to, you know, a judgment has to be a settled law. That's our understanding of the layman. But it appears as if you have the money and you can have expensive lawyers, you can agitate the same issue over and over again and the doors open. I don't know how this can happen in a country which has such huge pendency and, you know, some people don't even get a hearing for 10 years.
I agree with you. You know, they have all the time for hearing the same thing again and again. Because the banks can really engage very such lawyers who cannot be, you know, refused or who cannot be, you know, ignored. And the same thing goes on and on. I don't know when will this thing will be settled. The political parties not coming under the RTI is the biggest travesty the Information Commission's history. When political when the candidates can disclose their assets, their criminal cases against them, what remains to be disclosed? Why have they been afraid of really coming under the RTI? Same is the story with the in the case of bank inspection report, Suchita ji, since you are deeply into financial sector, sometimes the banks argue that the inspection reports contain information, disclosure of which would create, you know, panic among the investors and the depositors in the bank. And if there is a mass exodus from a particular bank because of certain comments contained in the inspection report, the financial institutions will suffer, and that would be not in the economic interest of India, etc., etc. In fact, Section 8(1)(a) does indirectly refer that any information disclosure which would have an impact on the economy or the financial stability of the country, that information will not be given. What the Reserve Bank of India could do is to tell the banks that please block those portions of the inspection report which in their opinion should not be disclosed to maintain the financial stability of the bank concerned. But rest of the inspection report should be disclosed.
In fact, Mr. Mishra, MoneyLife has published some of the reports that were given. And what you say has exactly been done. In fact, the RBI takes the report. It redacts everything. Anything that is a proper noun or a name has been redacted. In fact, far more than what you're worried about. And only then the report is given. Even that the banks want to object to, they go to the Supreme Court and they do not honestly tell the court that we are not providing information. RBI is providing only heavily redacted reports in any case. But they're still in court and they get entertained by the court. They are allowed their day, you know, of arguments, and they'll probably succeed as well.
I think Shailesh ji should ask from the public sector banks at least how much money they are spending on the lawyers. In the RTI related case, that what is the legal expense incurred by a bank in the last 5 years in the matter dealing with the X order. You specify the order and say, and then get this information. At least the public should know how much money has been spent.
Sir, it would be refused. And whenever I go to the commission, I now almost don't go because it takes 2 years or 3 years for a hearing. So right to information becomes right to history.
No, but Shailesh ji, as I was, see, at least this much, this information cannot be, or there is no possible ground to refuse this information. If I say that State Bank of India or Canara Bank, how much money has it spent in the last 2 years on legal expenses? Out of which, how many case-wise, I mean, if they can give that case-wise expense, fine. If not, they can say that we can ask them that please tell us that in dealing with this particular in which you had appealed or filed an SLP in the Supreme Court of India, how much have you spent on this in legal expenses? Let them say no. Let's see.
Sir, let me explain to you how absurd rejections are happening. Mm-hmm. I had asked DOPT for number of IAS officers whose annual confidential reports have not been received for 1 year, 2 years, 3 years, 4 years. No names.
Mm-hmm.
Rejected under Section 81J.
How is DOPT?
No. Now what PIOs do is, they say, I don't care. You go to the commission, it'll take 2-3 years, fir dekhenge. Anything they don't want to give, nahi dena hai. The law has been set aside.
Actually, it will kill the RTI Act completely.
It is becoming like that.
And the message which is going around is that probably you can do it with the impunity.
Absolutely.
We have one interesting example. Pune-based RTI activist Vivek Velankar. So he filed RTI to SBI. So SBI refused, but he's a shareholder. And so he asked as a shareholder the information, name of defaulters. The bank gave him the list last year, but this year they refused to share the list also. They're not sharing the names of defaulters, big defaulters who had defaulted 100 crore and more. So this is the way it's going on. I mean, they are not even giving the information to the shareholder. Forget about RTI activists. We have an interesting question from Mitu, who has got an order from the CIC against the an autonomous engineering college in Odisha on the ground of violation of policy. However, the order has not been implemented, the CIC order. And as an applicant, so she's asking what is the next option.
See, the engineering colleges are regulated by a central body called AICTE. So, if the order of the Central Information Commission is being ignored by that autonomous engineering college, then probably Mithu could complain to the AICTE and ask the AICTE to give a direction to the engineering college concerned, or probably if he can manage, he can go to the High Court in Odisha and say that the CIC had passed this order. But you know, these are expensive propositions. A common citizen like Mithu, where he will have to get a lawyer, pay money to that lawyer, then make an application. I think, I don't know whether he would like to do it. So this is the whole situation with the Shailesh ji, with the RTI Act, because it's good as long as people think it to be good. If people don't support the law, then what do you do really?
India, with a claim of becoming a world leader, ranks 79th on the rule of law index.
Yeah, that's true. As I always have said in the past, in many of our lunch time discussions in the CIC, that in India, unfortunately, out of 135, 140 crore people, you can't get even 10 crore people to have a consensus on where to walk on the road. As simple a thing that you put this question that everybody should walk on the left side of the road and you get a consensus. You can't even get 10 crore people out of 140 crore people who would be on the same. I mean, after all, what is law? Law is the consensus of the society. So there is nothing around which there is a total consensus in India. Not total, even 50% of people, even 20% of the people are not. After all, we are electing governments with only about 30% votes or 35% votes. The majority party which wins an election in the central government or in the state government doesn't get more than 30-35% of the total votes.
Any other questions, Yogesh?
No, we don't have any questions. There are some comments asked by, posted by people. Praful Babu is asking, why are covers with the names of black money holders lying in Supreme Court without being opened and making the content public? But
that's a tall order. Supreme Court has set up this commission called Saha Commission, in which Justice Saha and Justice Arijit Pasayat have been appointed to look into black money matters, if I recall right. And that has been going on for years now. I don't know whether Sucheta ji must be aware of this, that when Supreme Court appoints a commission or Supreme Court appoints a court appointed commissioner to do a certain thing, nothing could be a better thing for the person concerned than this. I know people who have been appointed as Supreme Court appointed commissioners and they have been staying in government house, going for a walk in Lodi Garden, enjoying, and they have been there till into their late 80s. I mean, doddering old people still continuing as court appointed commissioners. So therefore, nothing would come out of these things.
Thank you very much, Satyanand ji. It's been a great pleasure. And thank you very much for agreeing to come to this. And your conversation has been very candid. We all appreciate the fact that you've been so frank and honest in giving your views on various matters.
For two reasons, I would remember this conversation. A, that you got up at 4 o'clock in the morning to join. And B, I had thought, contrary to my earlier belief, that the name Sucheta Dalal must be that of a very elderly wise man. I find that she's such a young person. I mean,
she's 30 years old.
So that really, I'm surprised, because this name is very, familiar for so long. I mean, then this book, of course, is I saw it only beginning of the year, but the name Sucheta Dalal is an old, I mean, for so many years, I didn't think that a person with that kind of, public familiarity should be so young. Anyway, it is a pleasure, Madam Dalal.
Sir, we'll just take one question from Mr. B.S. Rangarao. Just a small question. Yes, Mr. Rangarao, you can ask your question.
I have posted my question in this Excel. Satyanand Misra sir and Sailesh Gandhi sir, I think Mr. Gandhi has been very familiar and I have already been in touch with him. Sir, we have come across a lot of public authorities denying or say deliberate studied silence to the extent of the second part of the 81J provision. That is, the information that cannot be denied to parliament cannot be denied to citizen. That part there, nobody is addressing.
Yeah, I'll tell you what is the problem. Mr. Gandhi also knows about this.
Yeah, that's it.
Unfortunately, there is no codified document in the government or in the Parliament of India which says what information can be denied to the Parliament of India. So in the absence of what information cannot be denied to the Parliament of India would have to be given, it's not known. I mean, how can a PIO sitting in some, say, in a tahsil headquarter or a police station in Visakhapatnam district or Srikakulam district or Kalahandi district would know which information can be given to the parliament or not? I mean, somebody should circulate. I mean, some government should circulate that this is the information which cannot be, or this kind of information, category of information cannot be given to the parliament, and this category of information can be given to the parliament. Only when that kind of clarity is given, then only the second part of the 81J can be implemented properly.
Sir, I would beg to disagree. Mm-hmm. Article 19.2 of the Constitution says what information can be denied, where 19.1A restrictions can be there. Mm-hmm. There are only two words relating to privacy, decency or morality. And whoever is claiming exemption under Section 81J must claim that I would not give this information to Parliament because it would violate decency or morality. It is for each adjudicator to decide whether it's commissioner, PIO or judge.
Yeah, I'm sorry, Shailesh ji, on that I have a bit of a difference of opinion with you. Article 19 doesn't define the parliamentary procedure. It only defines the right of the citizen. That the right of the citizen is circumscribed. Otherwise, the right to freedom of speech and expression is absolute, except that these are the following restrictions on it. But that doesn't really define or prescribe the procedure to be followed in parliament. Supposing a member of parliament asks a certain question, in what situation the government can say that this information cannot be given? Unless there is some kind of a codified thing. You recall we had written letters to the parliament, Lok Sabha Secretariat, asking them if they have a list of items on which the members cannot ask the question. Nobody gave us that kind of a, probably the parliament has not even drafted that kind of a. So what is necessary is for the law to be, enunciated more clearly, that the, as a proviso to 81J, that these kind of information cannot be given to the parliament, so therefore they need not be given to the citizens. In fact, that is not necessary at all. That second part is absolutely a redundant part. Nobody is following that.
Yogesh, anyone else?
Yes, sir. We are done with this today. Thank you very much, Satyanand sir and Shailesh sir, for joining us today.
So thank you so much, Money Life team, Money Life Foundation. I'm really extremely grateful to Shailesh ji and your entire team, Sucheta ji, for remembering, because one is becoming antiquity. So from the antiquity, you reclaim some people and remember me. I'm really grateful. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.